Yes.
We're all looking lovely today.
Hi, everyone. Thank you for being here. I'm just going to briefly introduce myself before Adam, our festival director, takes it away. And then we will get into our two keynote speakers, Kat and Stephen. I'm Francesca. I work at Wakakirri HQ. I'll be today's moderator. So if you have any questions that you want to send through in the chat, either hold them till the end and you'll have an opportunity to ask Kat and Stephen yourself and later Tony, or just as I said, send them through in the chat and I'll ask them at the end on your behalf. If we have any files we need to share or anything we mention, I'll also put that in the chat today. And with that, I will turn it over to Adam. Thank you.
Thanks, Francesca. Hi, everybody. My name's Adam Loxley, and I'm the Festival Director for Wakakirri. And thank you for joining us today for Careers Day. Before we start, I'd just like to do an acknowledgement of country. I acknowledge that I am recording this meeting on the land of the Wadi Wadi people. I acknowledge the traditional custodians of various lands in which we meet today. And in the spirit of reconciliation, Wakakirri acknowledges the traditional custodians of country throughout Australia and their connections to land, sea, and community. We pay our respects to their elders, past and present, and extend that respect to all Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples today. It's my privilege today to introduce our guest speakers. So with Wakakirri, we always like to surround ourselves with industry professionals. And we have two wonderful people here today, Kat Hoyos and Stephen Mahy. They're both working in the industry at the moment. They've got great careers in TV, film, and musical theatre. Kat, in particular, has featured in professional stages across in professional roles in the Australian productions of Jersey Boys, Hairspray, Bring It On, Xanadu, and Fame. Her on-screen credits include Here Comes the Habbies, Body in the Yard, and the short film The Road Home. She is featured in TV commercials for Bonds, Pepsi, Max, and McDonald's, amongst many others. So could everyone say hello to Kat, please? Hey, silent wave.
Hello.
Also, we have Stephen Mahy. Stephen is a singer and actor, best known for his starring role in the Australian production of Jersey Boys. Stephen has performed in numerous professional touring productions around Australia, including Miss Saigon, Grease, Little Women, Saturday Night Fever, and he is currently touring with the production of The Wedding Singer, which is a great production. So, yes, everyone, welcome Stephen. So let's get today's chat started. So Kat is up first, I believe. Okay, yes. Kat. Yes, take it away.
Okay. Hi, everybody. My name's Kat Hoyos. So there's a lot to talk about. I think where I'm going to start is where you guys are at the moment. So it's, you know, at school age and what brought me to how I got myself to where I am today. So I think as a young kid, I always had an inkling and a love for being creative. And I loved, when I was little, always being the one to perform. My mum got me into dance school first when I was little. It actually started from modeling. And then they said from modeling, maybe you should put her in some dance classes so she can be a bit more coordinated. So I went and did dance and then I was like, oh, I really love dancing. So mum stopped the modeling. I'm glad she did because I wasn't right for it anyways. So I did the dancing. And then when I got to like year 10, year 11 and 12, I was still dancing, but I went into drama and I really loved it. And so when I finished school, came the conversation about what I wanted to do when I grew up. And I wasn't quite sure. I wanted to be a vet. I wanted to be a marine biologist. Like I really loved animals, but then for those sorts of courses, you had to be really good at maths and I hated maths. So I was like, well, I don't think I'm going to do that. So mum said, I don't care what you do as long as you get a degree in it. So I was like, all right, cool. I'll lean into the creative arts field. So I auditioned for a couple of different schools. I wanted to stay local. So I'm in Sydney. I'm in New South Wales. I didn't really want to go interstate. So I was accepted into New South Wales Uni for dance and Wollongong Uni for theatre. And I picked Wollongong, even though I wasn't quite sure what I wanted to do professionally yet. I thought, well, at least I've got a 3-year solid acting degree behind me and it gives me an edge over the dancers if I decide to do this professionally. So off I went and I did my 3 years of acting. And it was fantastic because I'd come from a private school, all girls. So I was really exposed to lots of different people from different areas of Australia. I learned about humanity. I learned about human behaviour. I learned about myself. And over those 3 years, I grew as a person as well as a performer. And the thing that kind of started to fall behind, though, was my dancing because it was purely a focus on acting. And after that, I thought, well, all right, I think I'm going to just focus on dance now. So I did another year, a full-time dance course at Brent Street. And so now I had 4 years of professional training behind me. And that was a lot of dance-related, singing-related skills. But at the same time, I was getting a little bit of acting. But in saying that, obviously the strength wasn't acting. So it was a little bit of this when I was studying courses. I'd be stronger in one skill set. I'd have to work harder in this area. And then once I moved to another place, it swapped around. After that, I was like, you know what? I've done 16 years of full-time school. I'm going to go on break. So I backpacked for a while and I saw the world and it was amazing. I saw people in different cultures. I exposed myself to different countries. I learned how to be more independent. And I was also very fortunate because whilst I was studying full-time, I also had an agent at the time. So I was getting auditions and I was going to castings and whilst also studying, and I managed to get 6 commercials in that year. So all the money that I had brought in, I had put into the course, but also I was able to see the world with that money. And I'm so glad I did that. And then I came back and I was like, all right, I guess I'm doing this as a career because all I've done was lean into this area of creativity and decided I'm going to give it a red hot go. And I had an agent, I swapped around, got another agent, and off I went. I started auditioning for a bunch of different things. I was able to use all my skills. So I had my singing, my dancing, and my acting. And I was just really open to different opportunities. Whatever my agent submitted me for, I was like, all right, I'm going to give that a go. And there were areas where I was like, okay, I hated that. I'm never going to do that again. And then there were other areas where I was like, oh, I really like that. I'm going to keep doing more of that. So being able to be versatile was really important in the work that we do because I was able to float around and also enjoy different aspects of my skill set as I was moving through. So I was working as a singer in corporate bands. I did theatre and education. So that was going around to different schools and performing for schools as part of Book Week. I had done some character work, so I'd worked in suits. That was something I decided not to do again after my 2 goes. but I really take my hat off to those that venture in that world. I then worked also behind the scenes. So I worked as a choreographer. I dipped my feet into directing. I worked on stage just doing pure theatre at independent theatre companies. And then I sort of like wanted to explore more musicals. So I started auditioning for a bunch of musicals. And of course, you know, part of this industry is that we go through rejection. So that was a really big realization early on, of course. And it's not something that people hide. They say that's part of the industry. You're going to go for things and you're not going to get it. And then you're going to have a moment where you do get it. But it's hard because what happens is we put our self-worth and our value on the jobs that we get. So even though I loved it as a child, I didn't have that headspace of, well, I'm doing this because I want to get a job. I'm doing this because I love doing it. And that is a piece of valuable advice for any one of you who decides to take this on as a career, is that you have to remember why you're doing it in the first place. And it's not because of the money aspect, and it's not because you need it to survive. Yes, you do. Part of your heart is you love doing it, so you want that. But it's because we put the expectation and the result on the end of getting this job that makes it really hard. And we end up wanting to control the result, and we end up putting our self-worth into this job. And if we don't get it, then the whole world collapses around us, and I don't have anything, and I'm not good enough, and nobody likes me, and when am I ever going to get a job? This is the hardest part of the industry, is balancing that part of your self-worth. And last year when we had COVID, I took that on as a really valuable lesson, actually, because everything was taken away from us creatives in terms of the ways we make money, especially. And as a result, I was like, well, what am I doing with myself? And it got to a point where, obviously, because we were in lockdown, that my heart was yearning for something. And what I realized was that regardless of the monetary result, I still wanted to be creative. So I turned to things like playing my guitar again. I haven't played my guitar in years, and I had a creative outlet. Even though it wasn't making me money, it was making me happy again. And it's those little things that I connect to in my life that remind me that I am creative regardless of me making money or not, or getting the job or not. It's like soul food for me. Like, I love what I do regardless of getting money out of it. Like, I love to be creative. I love to collaborate. I love working with people who are inspiring and motivated. And I always like to surround myself with those people. It's very easy to get caught up in that conversation of people complaining that they never get anything, people complaining about something. There's always drama around them. So I'm always very cautious about the people I'm around, because it's that thing where you can get sucked into that, and then you become that person as well. So that's also a very valuable lesson to take on board, is who you surround yourself with. Friends, family is a big thing too. I always make sure, you know, if I'm feeling like I'm a little bit down, is there anywhere around in my life that is pulling me down in that way, and is there a way I can change that? So that's kind of a summary. I'll go back to my musical theatre. So yes, I did musical theatre. I toured around Australia. I was very fortunate to get that work, and it was awesome because I lived around Australia. I never got to do that with other work. I lived in New Zealand, and I loved it. I loved having consistency. I loved knowing where I was every week. I loved getting a paycheck every week. You know, there were perks to that sort of industry. So after a while, I was like, great, I'm going to go and focus more on film and TV. So I started to do more skills in that area. So as far as I got in terms of my theatre degree, it was more about doing the skills on a theatre stage. So then I started to explore film and TV as a skill, and that's very different. So once I did that, I then started to go on an audition, and I was going for like small things, landing commercials. I got my big break through a short film called The Road Home. And that was exciting that someone went, great, we love her and we want to use her in this show. And being it, you know, from a dance background, I was like, oh, this is a huge moment for me. This is a milestone. And so I did that and used that to find other ways in, to get with casting directors and keep working on my craft. Like, that's another massive skill to keep honing in, because you have to stay motivated, and you're always going to go through those areas of rejection. but use that rejection to keep working on your craft. There's a big word and it's called resilience. So that's something that I've taken on board as part of being in this industry, is that you have to be resilient. And to be resilient for me is to keep showing up no matter what happens. Yeah, because you're going to have moments where you'll go in the room 20 times, 30 times, back to back, and you won't hear anything. And so there will be those times where you'll feel like, oh, okay. Oh, okay. Okay. And it'll start to dip. So part of that resilience is being able to go, okay, let's try again. Okay, let's try again. Yeah. And it's just checking in with yourself and how you're feeling and going, all right, is there anything I can do for myself at the moment to keep me inspired and to keep me happy and to keep me positive? You need those friends around you that are like, go for it. I believe in you. You're going to make it. You need those people around you. You definitely need a good support system around you. I can't stress that enough, because in this industry, you will feel like you're alone a lot. And especially when you take yourself out of your home and out of your comforts. To give you an example, so after I landed Here Come the Habibs, that was a huge show. We were very, very successful. It put me on a commercial level. You know, I got a lot of exposure out of it and a lot of recognition, and people said that I was a comedian and, you know, got to celebrity level, and like, it was great. But I'm so glad that I had all the opportunities I had before it, because it put me in a great place to know who I am. And it's very easy to get pulled in different directions when you get kind of catapulted into that level of success in your career. So again, family, friends, they bring you and they support you and they keep you grounded, because it's very easy to get caught up in that situation. So going back to my example, that gave me an opportunity to then put myself to America. And I had an agent that got me a bunch of manager meetings. And so I headed off to LA and then had these meetings, got some rep, and then so became the next part of my journey, which was America. And so I lived in LA for parts of the year. And this is where I'm going back to with the whole family and friends thing, because now what's happened is I've taken all my comforts away and now I've put myself in a very new situation with new people, new culture, going on my career journey. And yeah, LA is a very lonely city because everybody's there for a reason. It's very business orientated. It's also very exciting. And the energy is really, really great, but it's also what you put into it. So if you feel like LA is a city where you get motivated and you're inspired, then that energy transcends into the way you walk into a room. But if you feel like LA is the kind of place where people are mean or they want something from you, or it's a very negative place, then you'll bring that energy into that space and people are going to feed that off you. They're very energy driven. So that's another skill that I had to learn being over there. And so being over there and being alone, it's like, how do you keep yourself motivated, and how are you going to help yourself with your support system? It's very important to know who those people are that you can kind of lean into when you're having a rough day. So coming back, I've been doing a bit of that and auditioning for a bunch of different projects. And yeah, the most recent thing I had done was a show called Amazing Grace on Channel 9. So I got that job through COVID, which I was like, woohoo. Oh, it's a rough year. But it was great because I worked with amazing people and no pun intended. And it was a chance for me to just be creative again. And it was beautiful. It was beautiful, the people that I worked with and the stories that we were telling, because it was about, you know, midwives and women having babies and the stories around that, real human experience. And it just wrapped on air, I think, 2 weeks ago on Channel 9. That's pretty much my whole journey. I don't know time check. Adam, how are we going? I just want to make sure I'm not waffling on.
I've got no idea how you're going. I've just been enjoying listening to you.
Because I won't stop talking. Where are we?
I'll jump in, Kat. It's Francesca. You've got about 5 or 6 more minutes.
Okay, so great.
Switch over to Stephen.
Cool. Thank you. Yes, so now going back to Wakakirri. When I was in high school, I didn't have an outlet like Wakakirri to be creative in. So I was only, like, I had dance school where I could do that, and then I had drama class, and then I went to a Catholic school. So obviously things like liturgical performances and, you know, the choir, band, that was sort of where I could live creatively at school. What I would have loved was to have an opportunity like Wakakirri, because it, first of all, you get to perform in front of all these other schools. It's a real public domain. There's lots of different faces and spaces that you're exploring. You get to collaborate as a team and come up with a concept, and you're essentially your own director and choreographer. So you're putting your creative stamp on a story that gets to be told to not just within the school, but outside of the school. And that's really cool. And it's also like a great moment for you to know who you are as an artist. Like, where do you lean into? What are your skills that you feel like, oh, I can really push myself in this space? Or are there areas that I'm learning a lot from that I can keep leaning into and exploring? Because those moments that you have at school will really determine your personality as well, and what you pick up, like visually, what you pick up orally, like what kind of person are you on a creative level? And perhaps that can give you an idea on where you want to go next in your career. So, you know, it doesn't mean that you have to be in front of people or in front of a camera. It can mean that you work behind the scenes. Like, maybe you see yourself more as a writer because you've helped create a script with your story dance. And that's what you really love. And so you're like, cool, let's explore more of that as I get out of school. Or you can go and create your own projects outside of school. So it kind of puts the pressure on a little bit, because you know you have to deliver a concept and an idea, and there's a due date. So you have to be responsible for that. It's all like well and easy to be like, yeah, I'm just going to write something, and then you don't do it or it never happens. Like, this gives you a place to go, all right, there's a delivery that's about to happen, and I'm part of this process, and this is where I lean into with my skills. Yeah, and it can be writing, it could be directing, it could be being a choreographer. Maybe you like the video aspects or the special effects that you create, and maybe it's costuming, maybe it's makeup. Like, there's a lot of different areas that you can put your hand up in and see what you like. And don't try and judge it or think, oh it's makeup. Nah. You never know. You never know where these skills may come in handy again. So don't dismiss anything. Take everything as an opportunity to learn something new, and always come in with that idea of curiosity. And curiosity is to go, I wonder what this is like, or how does this make me feel, rather than, oh, I hate it, I'm not doing it. Just go in with that kind of headspace and see what happens. And then after the experience, you can go, cool, did that, glad I did it, not for me. Let's try something else. Or love it, I'm going to do more of it. And then perhaps it may give you an idea on what you want to do outside of school or when you graduate. But whatever it is, the best kind of advice out of all of that is just to lean into whatever feels good. And if you feel good, keep going further and into that space. And when you feel good, you bring out joy. And when you bring out joy, there's this beautiful energy that will come out of you, and people will want to lean into that. So the more happy you are and the more joyful you are, it's just this instant feedback for an audience. It's an instant feedback from your friends and family. It's like it's almost like the mask comes off and you're just living in this beautiful state of being present. So opportunities like Wakakirri are fantastic for exploring who you are as a creative person. So yeah, that's my chat, I think.
Thank you so much, Kat. That was a really beautiful explanation of your personal journey as an artist.
Thanks.
Yeah, it was gorgeous. Absolutely lovely insight. Thank you so much. So we will save our questions for Kat until the end, but guys, start thinking about them. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to our second keynote speaker, Stephen. Thanks so much.
Hi, everyone. Thanks very much for having me and spending an afternoon with us and chatting about what Wakakirri is and what it means to us and what it means to you as individual schools. And I feel really honored that I could be a part of it. I was a host of a couple of the events a couple of years ago, and I was so inspired by every student and every school that came out that I was like, I have to be a part of this somehow and see more of your work and see more schools tell a story from a really truthful place. I was blown away by the issues that came up, global warming, individualities. There was just so much going on. And I think the year of the sloth was part of like the theme. So it was just interesting to see how everybody incorporated it. And going off what Kat said in the sense of like, you guys now have that opportunity to write your own piece and perform. It kind of brings me to kind of where I wanted to go. I can talk about myself later. We can go there if you really want to hear it, but Kat touched on something about individuality and being who you are as a person. And I'm turning 39 this year, and I'm finding in my last 5 years of my life that I'm still finally just being relaxed in who I am and stopping having to try really hard to impress everybody, to make people like me, to think about myself more. And you're probably going, sure, what do you mean? Like, you're an old man and where are you going with this? But I wish when I was in primary school and in high school that what I was doing in my craft, to choose to sing, like at 5 or 6 years old, my voice hadn't broken. So I sounded like a soprano, like female voice. And I used to get bullied so much because I had this really high-pitched voice, but I loved to sing. But what happened was that my light was dimmed because I was like, well, I'm never going to sing in public again. I'm never going to sing around the piano with my family because they've never have insulted me about it or made me feel bad. But I started to sort of feel this, performing is not for me. It was only something that I'll do a little bit, but if I did any inkling of it other than playing sports at school or doing the normal of what the society thinks that is normal, I came up against a lot of friction there. And so I encourage you all to stay really grounded in what you're doing, and performing arts is not by any means the wrong thing to be doing. A lot of people will say it's a career. It's like, why would you choose that? Like, you're going to be, you should go and get a degree and you should earn money in different ways. But yes, explore all avenues at school and have those opportunities to learn everything. Absolutely. I wish I was a bit more academic and I studied more, but I did every excuse to sort of get out of that confinement and that area where I was being bullied, because when I was on stage and when I was performing or I was telling stories and singing, I just had the biggest smile on my face, and I still do now as who I am today. And so I don't want people to, you see it in social media that boys shouldn't be dancing, or girls only do this and boys only do this, and it's absolutely incorrect. And I'm very passionate about finding gender equality. And what I mean by that is that there is a huge difference between men and women in the world. And there's a huge misogyny patriarch that is is kind of damaging to a lot of people, to damaging to men themselves, in a way that boys or men grow up. And I think you guys have a really important time now. And whether it doesn't have to be your theme, or you don't have to write this into your shows, it's not what I'm saying. It's just that you're in a very pivotal point in your lives where you're being influenced by so much. I'm really glad that I didn't have social media growing up, because I don't know, it influences so much of what we're doing now. It influences me. Like, I sit on my phone and I'm scrolling and I'm looking at other people and worrying about, like, how many likes I've got or what dances I've created on TikTok. Like, it's just this strange world, which I take my hat off to you, how you're navigating through that. But we have to start respecting each other as human beings. And I think there's lessons that we'd like to teach the top, like our politicians or the people that are, you know, do a lot around us, that can convince us that we're doing the wrong thing or that we're doing our jobs the wrong way. The arts is so important, and you now have an opportunity to treat each other as equal. The men and the boys that are listening, we have a responsibility to treat the women in our lives much better than anyone has been treated now. And it's a big conversation, but I put it out there because I believe that we are not equal as human beings. And I'm a white privileged male, and I very much live in a privileged world. And I say that because I don't have to worry about what's going to happen to me when I walk home, if I'm going to go to an Uber, if I get into going to a show and people, you know, they look at me very, very differently. And I think the responsibility we have as human beings, and you guys now, to kind of just start thinking about it, that we should treat each other equally. Men should respect women. And I know this is a bit of a rant, and forgive me, but I just find it really important that I wish I was taught this at school. And you're not going to get taught this at one of the big schools, WAPA, VCA, QUT, whatever. You're not going to be taught how to act as a human being. And I think that's what I seen a lot of, it will come to your auditions and it will come into who you are as a person and who wants to work with you, is that if you are a nice person, if you are treating people with respect, that's what's going to book you a job. That's what's going to get you into the drama workshop. That's what's going to book you the solo gig. That's what's going to get you the lead role, is when you start treating people as individuals with respect, respecting someone that might disagree with you. You might have a different opinion and they might have a different opinion. Either both of you could be wrong, but at least let's find a way to communicate with each other. And with Wakakirri, you guys have an opportunity to start making some pretty bold choices, and you can send a message out there. And it might be that you could teach your parents, or parents, like friends of your parents, through this and go, wow, we need to listen. We need to listen about the LGBTQI community. We need to listen to our trans life people. We need to listen to non-binary people, because I don't know enough about it, but I think that your generation are certainly there and very powerful in your messages on social media. But with Wakakirri, it's like, wow, you guys could show an amazing message and give us a lesson that we need to learn. And I remember speaking to a couple of the parents after the shows, they were like, I didn't know that my child even thought like that. I didn't even think that my child had a voice. And it's like, yes, that's what the arts is. Like, it gives us a voice to express ourselves in many different ways. And we can make choices. We can say no. We say, no, I don't want to do that. Or no, that is incorrect. You know, the right person should be cast in the role. The right person should be there. It's not just, let's just put on a bit of makeup. Let's just change the way one person looks just to satisfy what the script says. No, like, we need to work harder and represent what, if it's specifically Australia, if we do want to talk about, like, we are a multicultural country and we should be accepting everything that is going on. And I put my hand up and say that I've made mistakes. I've said the wrong thing. I've put myself forward when I shouldn't have put myself forward. So I hope that with this little rant, that you guys can maybe have that thought process and have the conversations at school and bring this up in your discussions on how we bring these performances together, because you have a voice, your voice is powerful, and individually, you all should be very, very proud of yourselves, of who you are today, regardless of being performing arts or whatever. You should be very, very proud of who you are. And I very much look forward to seeing those performances come alive in some way. And it, as I said, doesn't have to be about what I've just been talking about, but just those little filters now to start talking about it in class, especially in drama, because we're a little bit more out there. We're a little bit more fun, and we can talk about things a bit more freely because, I don't know, it's something within us, artistic people, that we can talk about that. And I certainly didn't when I was at school. And going back to that, you know, I did sing at school. I sang in the choir. I started doing ballroom dancing within my primary school. And I'll never forget, it was like just the funnest time of my life to be able to start expressing myself. My father was very strict on me. And he's like, you know, I want you to play sports and I want you to do this. And I loved it. It was great. But my sisters were singing in the mirror with a, you know, their hairbrush. And I was like, give hairbrush to me. I want to sing in the mirror with you. And I loved getting up in the morning and watching Rage and Video Hits. And like, there was this sort of question about like, is that because I'm a girl, or I'm like what people used to call me, like, am I gay, or am I, is there something wrong with me? It's like, no, I just loved it. I grew up on the northern beaches of Sydney. So it's a very white privileged area, but my mum and dad didn't earn a lot of money. And so going to classes and going to things was really hard for like probably about year six till about year nine. I didn't really do too much, but what we had was this amateur theatre production company called Forest Youth Theatre Company. And when you turn 13, you're allowed to go and audition for the show. And we did two shows a year. So from 13 to 21, I was doing amateur shows with this company. And it's invaluable what experience you can find in amateur theatre shows. And you learn what the community is about being in a musical, everybody painting the sets, finding costumes from somewhere, and a sense of being in a community. Like I'm sure when you come together to do classes now, but Wakakirri is that community, the sense of everybody striving to do, put on a great show and tell a story. And that's what Forest Youth Theatre was for me. It was my sort of almost my new home, because people were exactly the same. There were, there's people doing what I love to do. And so I look forward so much to get out as much as possible out of school, which I'm not saying you should, but it is so much fun when you get to go and play and explore who you are. And I was terrible. When I first did my first show, I just had no skills. I just sang around the piano. I didn't have singing lessons. And so it was just fun and a great opportunity. And then can those like times when for me anyway, 14, 15, 16, all of a sudden like puberty happens, you're like, whoa, what's going on? Like my brain's exploding. I'm at school, I'm learning stuff at school, and I'm also singing and playing sports. And I just found that with the arts, it was so incredible to be able to attach myself to something that I really did love. But also there's pressures from your parents, and there's pressures from friends and saying, you know, you should be doing this, or you should come out and do this. And, you know, I was very much influenced by people around me, and I should be doing, you know, play sports. So I ended up playing like representative football for a few years up until I was about 17, 18. And I thought, great, I'm going to be like a professional rugby player. But I just never had the passion or the desire to just keep going with it. It was always a musical, or it was always something that sat there that I needed to creatively go for. And I've been very lucky that in the last 15 years of my career, I've been working and being able to have that experience. But it came from also a lot of doubt and a lot of rejection, as Kat spoke about before. I remember getting to about 17, 18 at school going, okay, what are you going to do? I had careers day with my careers advisor, and she's like, what are you going to do? And I was like, well, I just want to sing and I want to act, and this is what I do. And she's like, really? Is that your career? And I was like, oh, okay. Like, again, someone just like putting this lid on, like, what's the arts? And like, I graduated high school in year 2000. So, you know, things that are shifting, are changing. So I was like, okay, well, maybe I can't make a career out of being an artist. And so I was like, right, I'm going to make some money. I'm going to join a corporate world and sell mobile phones for 3 years. And I was like, yes, I'm wearing a suit to work every day. I'm living the ideal life of what people expect me to do. But I was internally just absolutely not happy. And I got an audition for an amateur show called Les Mis which Les Miserables, which I'm sure you may know about. It's pretty popular show. But I just remember getting on stage. I wasn't even like one of the leads. I was one of the students, Fui, who got to sing this beautiful note like halfway through the show. And I just remember singing this note one night, and I was like, this is me. This is what I want to do for my career. And I just said, you know what? I'm going to quit my job. I'm going to audition for all the schools, all the music theatre degree schools. And I got into Western Australian Academy of Performing Arts, WAPA, in 2004. And it was a big decision to move from Sydney to Perth all by myself, because I was like, okay, how is this? What do you do? Like, I'm going to Perth. I've never been to Perth in my life. I've barely been out of Sydney, Northern Beaches bubble, because that was just the life that I lived. But it was the best decision I ever made. And I also want to kind of say that going to a university isn't everything. That, like, it's not the be all and end all. Like, if you finish high school or you've a couple of years out of school and go, right, if I don't get into a course, I'm not going to be able to have a career, or I'm not going to be able to be an artist, because there are so many people that I work with now that have never been to any of those schools. They're now leading players in all of the shows, or they've had ups and downs just as much as I had. For me, I needed a door open out of my little bubble, and I needed to venture out. I needed to grow up. I needed mum not to do my washing. I needed to be able to cook my own food and leave my comfort zone. And why I think leaving your comfort zone is important: yes, it's amazing to have that support network, and when I get a bit older, I'm like, definitely I definitely need it now. But finding your own platform and your own feet, your own opinions, your own skills of cooking, whether you're good or not, doesn't matter. I just think it opened so many doors for me to be able to learn, to go and do classes, go and do singing, acting and dancing 5 days a week. At high school at the moment, it's obviously so hard to do all those things, plus doing your academic work, but it just honing on a skill that you really, really love. Go and do a ballet class if it's really hard and you're like, oh, I don't like ballet. Go and do a ballet class. Go and do a tap class. I'm not a dancer. I don't have two left feet. I can move. But I've been cast in dance shows before, and it blows my mind that if I didn't have those skills or I didn't go to class, then I wouldn't be able to do it at all. The whole saying about fake it till you make it, I really do try very hard, especially in a musical, to do that. And I think it's important to go and explore all those different avenues if you can, if you have the opportunity to, while you're at school, to take up that class, take up that workshop, or if it's a free seminar online, like you're joining today, it's like, join in and just, you might learn that one little thing that you could take with you for the rest of your life, or it just might be like, oh, that's a light bulb moment that I didn't think I needed or had. And so learning is such a great tool that sometimes at school would be like, oh, I couldn't be bothered learning. Like, I don't want to do another class, or I don't want to listen to someone that I don't actually know very well, or what do they do? Like, what do they know? They're just trying to absorb and watch as much as you can and be a part of so many different things if you can. Try all those things now, because as I've seen, and when you go out into the professional world, sometimes you just get pigeonholed into one block. And I bring that up is because, so I graduated from a music theatre degree at WAPA, and I'm a music theatre man. I got cast in my first show in Miss Saigon, which is just like, for me, I was like, whoa, okay, this is where I'm starting. I'm the ensemble. I covered Chris and John, the two leads in the show. I got to go on. Incredible. Like, this is a dream come true. That went on for 14 months. And coming out of WAPA, I was like, that's amazing. I got an agent and I had this amazing opportunity to do a show. Then I did another show and it's like back to back. Hey, I've done another musical. This is amazing. Like, you know, let's keep the ball rolling. But what I noticed was that, okay, oh, you're just a music theater guy. And that may sound really great. It is. It's fantastic. I love live performance and I love being in a musical because I can sing and I can act and I can move a little. But what it kind of also does is you can be trapped into a certain world that people don't go, oh, well, you're a music theater actor, not an actor. And that you'd be like, oh, what does that mean? And Kat kind of touched on it before, where she was like, you know, I had to go away and learn other skills, and I had to keep learning from other people. And I was wondering why I never got the opportunity to go into the room with casting directors, or I went for so many TV commercials and I was like, I'm not getting any. It's like, okay, I'm never going to be on TV. I'm never going to be on TV commercial. That's fine. I'll just sing. I'll keep doing that. Like 10 years out of Whopper, I wasn't doing a musical. I was training with other people in front of the camera, and I was doing trying this other skill out. And all of a sudden it's like, oh, that's right. I've got to remind myself that I need to keep training while I'm still in a professional. It's like I'm in a musical, so everything's fine. It's like, no, like you constantly have to learn. You constantly have to recreate yourself and reinvigorate yourself and find different skills that you have. And when I did that, this door, you know, a similar sort of story to Kat in the, that I all of a sudden booked like 5 ads in a year, and you're like, whoa, what just happened? Did my face change? Did my body change? Did I grow up, or did I stop taking the spotlight off myself and put it onto something else? And so I started to, you know, open up these other doors. And my point is just keep learning, keep exploring those different avenues, because you don't know who's going to be watching one time. You don't know who's going to be in the room when you walk in there. The point of rejection is very, very hard, but also you may be going into a room because a casting director's asked you to go in there and you may not be right for that. Or they go, actually, no, you're not the right fit, but I've got this other project that I'm doing and I've got you in mind. And 6 months later, you get a call and you're like, can you come and audition for this? And then you're booking a gig that you just had no idea was coming, and it comes like out of left field. And I think that's the joy of being in this industry. Yes, it's hard. Yes, it's, you're in the trenches, you're working, you're getting told no more than you're being told yes. You almost get a job and then you don't. But it's fun because you get to explore so many different avenues of yourself. You get to find what you're like when you're down in the dumps. You get to find out when you're really, really high and what life is like then. And you've got to find that happy balance, that beautiful sweet spot where you go, it's okay, I can take a knock today. Or, you know what? I don't feel so good today, but that's okay. And I guess this is where it comes as well with the mental health and finding about what we're talking about before, about having that voice and having an opinion and finding those things. It's finding your truth and finding that if you aren't feeling okay some days, that's absolutely fine. Or you're getting bullied, or something is happening to you from outside of the world or your world, then you got to reach out for help and reach out within the industry and reach out within people and talk to people, because we're communicators and we're very vibey. And so people may not know that we're, you know, there's something is going on underneath our skin. And so we have to take that moment to just go, okay, well, we perform and we're always out there, but sometimes our egos and our bodies need to be repaired. We need to look after ourselves and respect one another and help yourself. I've been in the industry now for like 15 years and I've seen different, I've had lead roles. I'm playing a supporting lead role now. I've toured the country and having an amazing time, being, you know, a leading man or being a supporting character. It's not the be all and end all in life of having this wonderful, glamorous life, because when it comes down to it, like at the end of the day, I still have to go to bed at night by myself. And I have to remember if I'm a good person and I respect other people and I listen and I learn. I think that that's the best lesson that you guys can start creating now within yourselves, is how to start respecting the world that we're living in. And Wakakirri gives you that opportunity to say that message, to give a voice to something that you truly, truly believe in. Find that, run with that. It may not work, but honestly, have that drive and have that passion in whatever you do. But if you're the next generation to come and be in the arts, then I wholeheartedly love what I do. And that is the point. I think we just need to love. There needs to be more love out there for each other, for ourselves, especially, because once you love yourself, then, you know, it'll just emanate. It'll just shine. So I hope that you guys, thank you for listening, is what I'm trying to say. But yeah, you guys are amazing, and I can't wait to see the performances. And I hope that something inspired you today to stay true to yourself and love one another.
Thank you, Stephen. Thank you, Stephen. Thank you, Kat. That was amazing. If you want to see more from Stephen and Kat, Kat has just wrapped up Channel 9's Amazing Grace, the first season. So you can watch that on 9 now, I believe. Is that right? Yeah, awesome. Stephen is currently on stage in Melbourne with the touring production of The Wedding Singer, the musical, which might be more of a millennial thing than Gen Z, but that was a huge part of my secondary school experience was the movie Wedding Singer. So I can't wait to see that when it comes to Sydney. With that, I would like to see if anyone has any questions. If you do, please just go on unmute and let us know or put it in the chat. If you guys don't have any questions, I definitely have a few after listening to that. I will start with one. And guys, maybe you can confer among yourselves while I'm talking and think of something to put in the chat. But my question is for, I'll start with Kat, but it's also for Stephen. You guys both talked about rejection. Like we all get it no matter what business we're in. Just as humans, we're all gonna get a lot of criticism and rejection throughout our lives, but it's particularly brutal for artists. So what do you tell yourselves after you've gotten maybe a piece of rejection that was a piece of work you really wanted or really needed? What do you tell yourselves so you're ready for that next audition so that you're resilient and always like thinking of yourself in the way you need to?
Oh, heavy. So something I've come to the realization of in recent years is the more I want something, the more it doesn't happen. So, and I think what the thoughts that go towards it are, perhaps it's a little bit of desperation. Perhaps it's a little bit of like, I need this and I'm going to control it and strangle it because I'm the best person for this role. And it's somehow not worked. I may have just like invested so much money on private lessons and the right coaching and doing all of that. And then I walk into the space and I don't know if it's the feeling or the energy that I'm giving out that perhaps it's that kind of like, whoa, too much. And then I've noticed on the reverse, when I've just gone in for things that not necessarily I don't care about, I do care about it, but there's that relaxation and that moment of like being present without needing to get something from it. I think that's what the thought is that I need this and I need this badly, as opposed to I'm here presenting who I am, the skills that I have, and if it doesn't work, it's all good. Because the minute I take out the result and that expectation and the pressure on myself to deliver, then the rejection doesn't seem so bad, because for me it's like, this is who I am right now, and if it doesn't work, that's okay. I'll go and present myself in another way. As long as I own the work that I do and I'm proud of what I've done and I've done the best I could, then that's how I own that moment, not putting the power onto them, but keeping the empowerment within myself so that I have that to bring into the next audition and to the next audition. And I don't really call them auditions. I just call them like invitations. And if it doesn't work, it's okay. I'm not going to hate myself or, you know, bang my head over the wall because I wish I'd done this better or I could have done this. And if I had done this and this would have happened. It's like, no, as long as you keep working on your craft and you've done the best you could, then own that. You've done the best you could. All good. Sign off. Move on to the next thing.
I love that. I'm gonna jump in because I actually have two questions for Stephen. I love this first question because I'm a big fan of stagecraft and technical theater. Those roles are every bit as valuable as being a performer. But, this question is, what are some of the less known but interesting offstage roles? And the second question is, would you be willing to sing for us?
Let's go for the first question first. can you maybe say it again? What is some interesting offstage roles that I've done, or what is some offstage roles that people can do?
Yeah, Alicia, do you want to clarify for us? So you've asked, what are some of the less known but interesting offstage roles? So I'm interpreting that as like stagecraft or working behind the scenes. But in the chat, do you want to let us know if I've got that right?
Can we talk about sort of like crew stuff? The stage, the lighting designers, who basically we're the kind of like last piece of the puzzle. So there are so many important pieces, especially in a musical. I mean, on any like a film or in on TV, there are so many different departments that create what the end product is. Even when it comes down to just looking at the script writer and what they've written. The fun thing about, I guess, let's talk from a musical point of view, is that you do have so many people working around you. So there is the stage management, and they look after everything that runs on the stage. And so what they do is they call the show. And what I mean by calling the show is that each lighting cue that happens, they'll be on a headset and they'll be going, okay, lighting cue LX1, go. LX2, go. And it all has to fall into in timing with the music. It all has to run very like the same every single night. And so they're there from day one. Usually you have a team of about 3 to 5 people if you're lucky. I'm in a show at the moment, we only have 2. So you can imagine running a big show, it's a little bit cut back. But stage management is a great one, because you do have to learn the musicality of the musical as well. So you need to learn how to read music, or at least know where the beats are. But then you also have to have the skills of communicating with the company on a daily basis, and controlling what everybody else is doing. So when you see a show, there's lots of things that fly in, and they're called, like, we have mechanists, or they sit up on the fly tower. They're the ones pulling the ropes up and down to make sure that the sets fly in and out. There's the lighting team, there's the sound team. So there's so many different variables of what you can do. Even running the theater, like you've got the ushers, and you've got the people that look after everybody that come in as well. And it's such an important piece, because without the audience, like, who are we doing it for? So I hope that answers the question. Is that, you know, are there other roles? Yes, absolutely. There's so many different things that you can do. Even look, when you pick up your favorite book and go, I wonder how that book could be made into a musical or into a play or into a film, because that's where the ideas come from. It comes from history. It comes from, you know, we write things about what's going to happen in the future or what's happening in society today. Like when you guys create your Wakakirri concert, it's like you all have to have those different hats on. And as an artist, that's what you do. And the end product may be that you're stepping on stage, but beforehand you've read it, you understood like where the writer's coming from and how this could look if you're on set, like how's this going to look when it's in a small frame. So there's so many different variables. Yeah. And when I'm going to, will I sing? I will sing for you, but this question is so funny because what am I going to sing is the question. So maybe have you got a question for Kat and I can think about singing something? I don't know what I'm going to sing. It's one of those, you're a singer, sing a song.
It's terrible of us to ask you, but yeah, do you guys have an impromptu duet, Kat and Steven, that you can do right now? I'm just kidding.
Well, we did do Jersey Boys together. I mean, we didn't do it together, but we did the show in different.
Come on, can you? Colors. That would be really impressive if off the top of your head, you guys could come up with a song to just do a little riff for us.
Oh, it's very difficult, but
Kat's... No, it's impossible. I'm sorry. you guys have been great. Thank you so much.
No, thank you.
Thank you. I think there's a question from Adam.
Okay. Yeah, that's great. We did have a question from Adam, and this was for Kat. It's a really great question, but what qualities did you look for in agents? Would you look for in an agent?
Couple of things. Good communication skills. That's important because part of the struggle with artists and agents is they feel like if they say something that the agent might not like it. And so it's a little bit of, it comes back down to your confidence. And I think the second thing too is someone that you can get on with and you feel comfortable with. That's important. And the third thing is that they are essentially hustlers and they are going out and getting the work and getting the audition, so you have the opportunities. If all those three points gel in together, then you'll have a great relationship with them for sure.
Kat, I've got one more question, and this is a great question. They are currently putting on the musical Xanadu. Do you have, what role did you play, and do you have any advice?
I played Arato. I'm trying to remember what muse, the music? No. Singing? No. Oh, I can't remember. It's been a while. The advice I have, the erotica. Thank you. There you go. That went really well. So the advice is, so Xanadu, the tone of the show is quite fun and a little bit pokey funny. So they like to poke fun at what's going on. So it's comedy. So I think the best advice for this kind of show is to really just lean into the idea of having fun on stage. And if you're having fun, then that will translate to the audience because it is a comedy. So it really depends on how you're directed in the piece. But yeah, have the opportunity and enjoy the moment of being able to just be your most dramatic self and, you know, be a little bit silly and just enjoy working with each other on stage and really like capture each other's connection. You know, the eye contact's important because you can keep playing and having fun and live in the moment. Yeah, it's a super fun show and the songs are really catchy. So, you know, you'll have a great time.
Brilliant. Thank you so much. Thank you both. Everyone who's in Victoria, New South Wales, where else, Stephen, do you still have to tour?
We're also going to the Gold Coast. So if you're on the Gold Coast, come say hi.
Yeah. Okay. Can't miss the Wedding Singer. And check out Amazing Grace on 9 Now. And everyone who missed the beginning of this, I will be sending out a video of Kat and Stephen's talk. So you'll get to catch up on it. Thanks so much, Kat and Stephen. Really appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody, for listening in. We appreciate your time. And thanks, Stephen.
Yeah, thanks, Kat. Nice to see you.
You too. Good luck with the run. I'll see you in Sydney.
Absolutely. See ya.
See you guys. Okay. To all of our students, we're going to take a quick 7 to 10 minute break if we could be back here by 2:10, that would be great, because then we are going to jump into our workshop with Wakakirri coordinator Tony Keeble. So when we get back, we'll be into that. Okay, see y'all in 10 minutes.
All right. Can everyone give me a thumbs up? They can see this. Wonderful, wonderful. All right. So this is our little workshop that's centered around the art of Wakakirri performance. Because Wakakirri is a very special performing arts festival, and there's a lot of little things that are integrated into the element of creating a story dance performance. My job today is really to kind of give you some tips and tricks and to hone in and finesse your skills surrounding the particular components that are, related to a Wakakirri story. So today's little workshop outline, we're going to talk about artistic expression and the main ingredients to a successful Wakakirri story dance performance. So I'm going to break those down for you, give you a little bit of an introduction, or maybe just draw your attention to certain things that you should probably be paying attention to when you're working your story and creating your performance. I'll also provide a video example of a Wakakirri story dance and what made it successful. So everything that I explain about the ingredients of artistic expression expression will be then demonstrated in a short little video clip from a previous year's performance that will sort of give you an idea of what I'm talking about and put it into some context. And then we're going to move into a creative task. So this is going to be a little activity that all of you would like you to participate in. This is something that you're going to do in your groups in your school. So you're not going to be interacting with anybody else online. It's just going to be with the people inside the classroom with you. If you're by yourself today, definitely still do the task, work on the task as a solo element, because all of the parts to this task still relate, whether you're doing it as a big group, small group, or by yourself. And then we're going to do a little quick presentation of these creative tasks. I might not get through to everybody today. There'll probably just be a few people that will be demonstrating. And then for the rest of you that don't get a chance to demonstrate, I ask you if you could record your little presentation and send it through to us, because I'll be able to provide some constructive feedback that will sort of, you know, guide you for the next stages of your performance process, so to speak. And then there'll be time at the end for a student Q&A. So if you do have any questions specifically that I haven't kind of covered, then you've got that opportunity at the end of the session. So as I mentioned, we're looking at the art of Wakakirri performance, and there are four main components or ingredients that are part of the Wakakirri performance piece. And those are what I call your artistic expressions. So they cover story, choreography and movement, performance and production elements. All of these work together as one. They're not separate parts that you demonstrate at different times. They're all integrated. And that's what's really important for you to remember when you're kind of exploring your story and creating your movement and thinking about your performance pieces and all of the stagecraft elements that are associated with that. They're not separate. They all really work together. And that's what makes a successful performance too. Okay, when schools really integrate and use all of these parts together throughout the entire performance, that's what makes a successful Wakakirri story dance. And so we're going to break those down. So we're going to look at story, then we're going to look at choreography and movement, followed by performance, which is kind of all of the elements regarding how you present your stuff on stage. And then we're going to look at the production elements. And production elements are stuff like music, costume, set and props. Okay. So we're going to start off with story. Okay. So the story is kind of like the heart of this performance. We need to have a strong story that gives the audiences an understanding of the context, okay? And so that they can be brought into a world that makes sense, yeah? So understanding how the story works is the first stage, I would say, in creating your performance. So that comes down to three little parts to that. That's the setting, so knowing the location, the environment, the time and space in which the story takes place. It may change throughout the story, but giving a clear indication of knowing where you are in the story, according to the setting, is really important for you to connect with that setting. The next part is the progression. So this is how the story unfolds, the events that sort of occur within the story, the barriers or obstacles that kind of go along the way. Your character that you might play in this story may face obstacles, okay? And how do they overcome those obstacles and the achievements that they make at the end of that and how that's reflected in the character. These are what will all need to play a part and be represented as a performance, okay? So not just having the story be separate, but having the story be inside the character that you're playing or the person that you're performing as. And then the last part is obviously the characters, the connection to those two other parts that I just mentioned. So, you know, how does your character connect to the time or the location in which the story is taking place? And then how does your character connect to the progression? So in Wakakirri, we really like that the stories have an orientation, a complication and a resolution. So how does your character fit within those certain stages of that progression? That's what's going to create a fuller performance, and then it's going to also give you more space to perform. So as opposed to just having one kind of expression, say, on your face, you now have an ability to change and adapt because you're following how the story progresses as well and how that might influence your performance, okay? So the story is a really key part here in how you perform on stage. You need to know what the story is. You need to know what the other characters are doing. You need to know what the ensemble or the leads are doing if you're not part of that role. You need to know the entire beginning, middle to end progression, that you're not just working within one scene, that you're kind of got a bit of context. That's what's going to create a fuller character and allow for the audience to really connect with your performance. The next part here is choreography and movement. We know that Wakakirri is a story dance. We're using dance or movement as a way to tell that story. So fundamentally, the major tool here is movement or choreography. So understanding what dance actions or gestures are going to help communicate that story is what creates a strong performance. So, you know, a lot of schools, when they first get started, they just sort of create movement but don't really connect it back to the story. Your movement should really represent what is happening in that moment in the story. And of course, that's going to change, but there does need to be a connection. So if you're part of the team that's helping create choreography, or you have a choreographer creating the movement for you, it's important that you find ways in which those movements connect back to the story as your character, so that there is a relationship with both movement and the story itself. If you are working collaboratively to create this movement as a team or as a crew, then knowing which kinds of styles will be really, really useful to help with the expression of that story as well. So, you know, we all know the different kinds of styles in dance, lyrical, contemporary, hip hop, jazz, all of that. They all really have a different way to kind of connect to an expression. So making very, very strong and obvious choices about how your choreography and the style of that choreography connects to the story is going to even elevate your performance even more. And it will also help you kind of connect with that expression as well. If you are, again, working collaboratively to create the story process with movement, think about how literal and non-literal movements can be put into the choreography to keep it interesting for the audience. So literal movement is stuff like if the words of the song say sunshine, and in the moment of the story, the character is standing in the sun, then those are literal connections with movement. But you don't necessarily always have to work like that. You can work non-literally, and that's an interpretation. Okay, maybe sun rays is demonstrated through your formations. Maybe the sun rays is demonstrated with the feeling of what the warmth of the sun feels like and how that can be represented through movement. That's a non-literal interpretation. So working with a range of literal and non-literal interpretations of movement are going to create a really, really interesting story and make your choreography very, very, very rich. And then the next part is obviously once you've got that choreography, it's connecting it back to the character and making sense for the character. The character, if say the character is an old lady, you don't want your movement to then suddenly break out into classical dance and this old lady ends up doing 15 fouettes and doesn't really quite make sense for the character. You do need to make sure that the movement always connects back to the character. So understanding how that character may perform that movement will also help as well. And I highly recommend, if you haven't done this already or haven't explored anything called choreographic tools or choreographic devices, this is going to really help with the process. Just type into Google choreographic tools or devices and you'll find a full range of things in which you can manipulate movement to help create more layers to your performance as well. All right. So those are the parts in which choreography plays, but we do want to come back to story each time, that it's just not movement. It's connecting to the story. It's helping tell the story. The next one is all about performance, okay? So this is what is happening when you're on stage or even during the rehearsal process, developing this performance quality, as we say, or stage presence. And that really does come again back to the story, the character that you're playing, and the choices that are being made for that character in the moment of that story as well. So that's got to do with your facial expressions, that's got to do with your gesture, your stance, the projection, the energy in which you give yourself towards the audience, and how that might be inserted into the choreography. And does the choreography require more energy or less energy to tell that moment in the story? Your focus, so knowing where you're looking at and who you're connecting to. Are you connecting to another character? Are you connecting to the audience? Or are you trying to connect more internally with yourself? Knowing the focus is going to really also translate through the movement and then create a much more clearer understanding for the audience to connect with as well. The last part is about mood, okay? So you're knowing that you have to create a sense of feeling when it comes to your presentation. So it doesn't have to be so like cut and dry. You don't have to be like sad, happy, lonely. There might be more layers to that. And again, that's understanding your story and also understanding how your character operates within that story. And then the last part there is musicality. So obviously we're dancing and performing to pre-recorded music. That music should also give your performance clarity or give you a way to perform in a way that makes sense as well. So the production elements all got to do around music, set, props, and costume. I want to always remind everyone that you don't necessarily have to have big elaborate costumes or set and props to tell your story. You can really just be using choreography and movement and your performance to tell the story. These are all added extras that are going to enhance but not tell the story. So you don't want to rely on just your music alone or your costumes alone to tell that story. You want there to be the ability for that story to translate without all of these fancy elements. However, they are very useful. So do incorporate them. Just remember that they're not what drive the story as well. Okay. So that's making sure that the music kind of supports the story. The costumes may help with the choreography in a way, or even maybe it could help how the character stands or moves around the space. The set and props give you a chance to be focused. So knowing that if you are meant to stand in front of a tree, for example, that there's a purpose for that, that you're not just standing near a tree because there's a tree there, but there's a reason that you have to stand over there. And then finally, the lighting, because I know that for you guys, you are in charge of creating the lighting states. Understanding what that lighting does to create a mood in the story, as well as drawing the attention to the expression of the performer. So if there's a moment in your story where your character is feeling isolated and alone, and there's just a down light, that's going to enhance that mood. Okay. It's not going to tell the mood if you just put the light there and no one else is going to be there. It's to help enhance the mood of what's happening in that moment as well. Okay, so those are your production elements, yeah? Those are the four ingredients that make a really strong Wakakirri performance. And as I said, they don't work separately. They all work together as a way to create a really strong performance. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to actually give you a demonstration of a previous school, a school here in Victoria that won Story of the Year for their performance. And you're going to notice here that they've got some really, really strong moments in which demonstrate those different parts, the story, the choreography, the performance, like the projection, the connection, the focus, and the characters that they play, along with all the production elements that are also playing in that. I'm not going to play the entire thing. It goes for 7 minutes. I'm just going to show short little snippets at different points. So we'll jump around a little bit. It's just to kind of give you an example of an effective way to use those three ingredients together. So make sure you've got your sound on, okay? So you can hear it.
From LA to Tokyo, Holding on your rope, diamonds and feet off the ground. And I'm hearing what you say, but I just can't make you sound. You tell me that you need me, then you go and cut me down. But wait, tell me that you're sorry. I think I'd turn around and say, hey, that it's too late to apologize. It's too late. I said it's too late to apologize. It's too late. Bless your soul, you got your head in the clouds. You made a fool out of you, and boy, she's bringing you down. She made your heart melt, but you're cold to the core. Now rumor has it she ain't got your love anymore.
All right, you guys. So there was an example of those elements of story, choreography and movement, performance, and those productions elements all kind of working together as one. And that was what created a very strong and successful performance from this school, and which is why they ended up winning Story of the Year. So I hope that gave you a bit of clarity in regards to those different elements. Now we're going to move into a creative task. Okay. In the chat, you would have received some material in there to help with this creative task. So there will be a little sample story inside that chat, along with some music that's been provided to you. What I would like you to do is have a read of that sample story and just kind of get yourself familiar with that and select a part of the story that you wish to work on. You don't need to demonstrate the entire story. You might just pick out certain little elements that are sort of operating in that story. And then your main focus is to look at choreography slash movement and performance and how you could use those two ingredients together to create a little mini story dance. So I want you to create something for no more than a minute, okay? And you can work with the music to kind of help with that, but to sort of see how you can interpret the story by using those little ingredients that we've just gone through. So working with choreography and movement, so making choices in regards to the kind of style you might use or the representation of that movement according to the story, and how those characters, yeah, the characterization within the performance also connect, okay? You'll have 15 minutes to construct this little short little task, okay? So work together in groups. If you're a large class, okay, if there's a big group of you, maybe break yourselves up into smaller groups, okay? The story allows for this to be done in big or small groups, depending on what part of the story you choose, okay? But you've got 15 minutes to construct that little mini story dance. And then we're gonna come back and present those little performances later on after that 15 minutes. If you've got anything in the room that you want to use, such as chairs or any kinds of props that you think might be appropriate, remember, production elements are there just to enhance, not to tell the story. But should you have something that might help, go ahead and use that, all right? And then work with that music. That music goes for about a minute or so, okay? And see if you can try and integrate that music into your performance as well, okay? So I'm gonna give you 15 minutes to do that, and then we're gonna jump back in. If you have any questions during this little 15 minute construction period, just come back, chuck it into the chat box, or turn your mic on and call out, and I can clarify anything along the way. All right. Can I get a thumbs up from everyone? Everyone's okay with that and good to go? Wonderful. All right. So in the chat box, you'll see the story. Okay. Have a read of the story first. Choose an element from that story that you think might work. Apply choreography and performance to that little area of that story. use the music or some props if you would choose to, and then we'll jump back in and do a little bit of a demonstration. Off you go. Have fun.
If anyone has any questions, feel free to pop them into the chat or just pop back on voice. Please let us know if you need any help. We'll be here.
Yep, and the instructions are going to stay up on the screen, you guys. So you can see all the instructions there for this creative task. So you can come back to that if you're confused.
And also, we would love it if you all wanted to present. But if you don't want to present, you can send us your video afterwards. And Tony will give you personalized feedback.
No questions? No comments? Okay. Well, I would like to say thank you once again for joining us here for this little workshop. We hope you got something out of it today, whether it is understanding how to put all the parts together and making sure that it's all working together, or whether or not you need to kind of maybe build a bit more in one of those elements, or just that little bit more for when it comes to creating your story. Hopefully that all makes sense, but it was lovely to see everyone. Can I get big waves as goodbyes, please? Thank you very much, you guys. We'll see you.
Thank you. Thanks so much, guys. Can't wait to see you. Hopefully at your performance shows later this year or maybe next year. Bye, guys.